Hello, everybody. This is Johns Hopkins with Baltimore Heritage, and I'm here with another one of our 5-Minute Histories. And today, we're going to go over to the Belvedere Hotel. Yesterday, if you tuned in, we talked about John Eager Howard and Mount Vernon Place, and that inspired me to go learn a little bit more about the Belvedere, and I'd like to share it with you. I want to say thanks to a gentleman who I don't know, Tom Siebert, but in 2003, he wrote an article for Baltimore Magazine on the 100th anniversary of the Belvedere, and it's really fantastic. We'll put a link to it. It's online, and we'll put a link to it at the end. So the Belvedere was built in 1903. By some of Baltimore's most wealthy families, including the Brown family, the banking family from Baltimore. And they hired architects out of Boston named Parker and Thomas. And these guys were for real. They've done some wonderful buildings. If you know the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad building down on Charles and Baltimore Street, that's one of theirs. The Savings Bank of Baltimore, just catty corner from the B&O. Building, also in Charles and Baltimore Streets. That's one of theirs. Formerly World Relief had their headquarters there. And probably their most well-known building, the Hancock Building in Boston. So when the Belvedere got started, the Baltimore families behind it told Parker and Thomas to spare no expense. And that they did. They followed their instructions. The style of architecture, if you're curious, it's the French Second Empire style. If you want to see another great example of that, Baltimore City Hall is a fantastic example. So the Belvedere opened up in 1903, and what I thought would do is take a wander through a couple of the rooms, because it's got a grand exterior, but it's got wonderful rooms on the inside. But before I do that, here are some of the cast of characters who we're going to wander with. They include movie stars. These are folks who have stayed at the Belvedere. They include movie stars, Clark Gable, Groucho Marx, and Al Pacino. Business tycoons, John D. Rockefeller and Andrew Carnegie. Sports heroes, Ty Cobb and Diamond Jim Brady. Musicians, Tommy Dorsey, Cab Calloway, and Kenny Rogers. Presidents, Teddy Roosevelt, John F. Kennedy, even Ronald Reagan. They include royalty, the Queen Marie of Romania, and they even include ex-royalty, the Duke and Duchess of Windsor. So let's start right in the first floor with the John Eager Howard room. Belvedere, if you remember, was the name of his estate, and the Belvedere Hotel was just about a block away from where his grand house once stood. The John Eager Howard room, if you go in the main door, it's just to the left. And it was not always called the John Eager Howard Room. It was called the Tea Room. And this is where Baltimore's high society would meet for tea, because the Belvedere Hotel was very much for Baltimore's high society and their guests. It was the Tea Room until, I believe, 1981, when it changed names and got a fantastic redecoration. The walls have wonderful hand-painted murals on Japanese rice paper, and I believe it won a National Interior Design Award for the work there, so check that out. Incidentally, one person who may have had tea there was the Duchess of Windsor. When you're standing looking into the room, just to the left is a small elevator, and when the Duke and Duchess came to Baltimore, that's where they stayed, on the top floor, and that little elevator was basically, they commandeered it to be their private elevator, so they could come and go without having to get into a small space with the rest of the rabble at the Belvedere. All right, let's go on up to the ballroom. The ballroom has had countless number of dances and cotillions and birthday parties. It's a fantastic space. It was used almost nightly during the heyday. Maybe one of the most odd and spectacular parties was one that F. Scott Fitzgerald threw for his daughter, Scotty. They were in town when F. Scott Fitzgerald's wife, Zelda, was getting treatment at Hopkins, psychiatric treatment at Hopkins. And he threw a party for his daughter and her friends, all young women, and it was quite the scandal. The Baltimore newspapers typically left the Belvedere alone. It was sort of like whatever happens at the Belvedere stays at the Belvedere or something like that. But this one they couldn't leave alone, and they reported on it. Fitzgerald caused a scandal by dancing with all of the young women friends of his daughters and getting completely drunk in the process, and then threw everybody out, shut the doors so that he could sit and drink for the rest of the night alone. I don't know, party on, F. Scott, or not, but that's what happened and got reported. Let's go on up to the 13th floor. The 13th floor was not always the bar on the 13th floor, called the 13th floor, was not always part of the Belvedere. It came onto being in the 1980s. The hotel had had a series of owners, I think maybe 10 or 11 in total, and basically lost money from the day it was built. In fact, before it was completed, the Baltimore families that financed it had sold the building before it was even done. The architects apparently, when they were told spare no expense, they did that too much. But it went to the Baltimore Trust Company, then the Union Trust Company, went through several hands. And in the 1980s, a Baltimorean named Victor Frankl bought it, maybe more out of love for the building than out of a profit motive. You probably know some of Frankl's other works. He built the Baltimore Arena, and he built what's today's Poly and Western High Schools. So the 13th floor was a creation of his to try to generate some revenue for the building that he loved. I remember, I haven't been there for probably 20 years, but it's known for its the carpets, the various types of carpets that it had on floor, reds and blues, I think. I remember it with a wonderful zebra stripe carpet. All right, we're going to go down to our final room, and that, of course, is the Owl Bar on the first floor. It was part of the original building in 1903, but it wasn't called the Owl Bar. It was just called the Bar, or the Bar at the Belvedere. But by the Depression, Prohibition era, a gentleman named Charles Consalvo had bought the building. Consalvo was a circus clown turned hotel owner, not a joke, and he was a flamboyant guy, to say the least. He and his wife occupied the entire second floor, and he apparently shocked some of the guests occasionally because he wandered around nude. But Consalvo was not super concerned about Prohibition, apparently. He ran a bootlegging operation, he brewed his own whiskey, and he had the audacity to label it the Belvedere, so I guess he wasn't too concerned about being caught. And Consalvo is the one who brought the famous owls into the Owl Bar, now what we call the Owl Bar. And the owls have lights in their eyes, and apparently they were connected to a buzzer system. When the federal agents would come, the alcohol folks would come and try to raid the Belvedere, the doorman would step on a little button on the floor and light the owl's eyes up so that all the patrons would know they got to change their whiskey out for iced tea pretty quickly. All right, so the next time we are able to go, I'd encourage you to go to the Belvedere, stop by the John Eager Howard Room and say thanks to a gentleman who helped shape Baltimore, and then raise a glass to Charles Consalvo, the circus clown turned whiskey runner who gave us the Owl Bar. All right, I will see you tomorrow.